Hello and good day to all of you. So in this lecture, we are going to learn about the vertical and horizontal resolution. So in seismic, vertical resolution is also called temporal resolution. So we go from this point to this point, and also the horizontal resolution, how the object in the subsurface can be identified, which is called the spatial resolution. So if this body has to be identified, then we have to come up with this type of acquisition geometry to get the subsurface picture. So before starting the lecture, so we have the learning outcome for this piece of lecture. So the first learning outcome is to understand the basic concepts and the parameters of the resolution. So we will be talking about the general resolution, what type of pixels we have in the resolution and all these type of things. Then we also, the objective of this lecture is to learn about the temporal and spatial resolution in seismic specifically. So let's look at the graphics resolution. So normally when we are talking about the pixel resolution, which is equal to, or which is the function of px into py, which is x dimension into y dimension, because it's a two dimension. And when the another thing in the graphics resolution is the color depth. So it's how many number of colors which we have inside the picture or any image. So that actually define the graphics resolution. So if we look at the specific definition of the pixel resolution in terms of the resolution, which refer to the number of count of the pixel in a digital image. For example, we can say that the higher in the pixel resolution, the higher the quality of the image. And also we can define the pixel resolution of an image by 4500 into 5500. So high resolution means the image details, or the details of the image are more clear. The image resolution can be measured in various ways. So the resolution quantifies how close the lines can be to each other. I mean, if you're talking about a picture, so how closely each pixels can be identified and still be the visibility resolved. So let's look at the pixel resolution to understand more about the pixel resolution. So as I mentioned, the pixel resolution is a function of px and py. So in this x dimension and y dimension. So whenever we have a picture on the right side, so this is actually a picture, but when we define the pixel in x and y, which is equal to 0 and 0, so the pictures look like this. So in this picture, so you can focus on this part and also look at the how we keep increasing the pixel, then how it's improved. So it's still the pixel is 0 because it's a black and white, or even you can't see anything. But when we increase the pixel, I mean 10 into 12, so px is 10 and 12. So you can see some part of the picture. So in this, you can see different colors. And also I'm not talking about the colors, how many colors we have in this picture, but specifically we are looking at the pixel right now. So when the pixel is 10 into 12, so it looks like this. When it's moved to the higher pixel, which is 25 into 29. So as you can see here, so there is, you can look at this picture. So this is actually a picture of a lady or the girl. But when we keep increasing the pixel, so it's about 50 to 58. So you can see the picture is becoming more clear and clear. Then we keep increasing 100 into 116, 150 into 174. So now you can see even the hair, the each hair of this lady. When we increase, so when we reach up to 270 to 313, which is a very minimum resolution. So from this resolution, you can see quite clear. I mean, if you zoom it in, maybe the pixel is still small. So I want to give you an example. Let's say if you are looking at this phone, which is Mate 20 Pro, which is from Huawei. So the pixel resolution for this phone is 1440 into 3120. So it means when I'm taking picture from this phone, so the resolution of this picture is very high. So this is the difference, I mean, how we use the pixel resolution in the graphics resolution. So if you look at the summary of this one, so when we are taking 10 into 12, 100 into 116, 270 to 313. So it's from here to up to here. So it's not clear, then this one is more clear. So now we look at the color. How many colors we have, or it's called the color depth resolution. So let's say, and how much the size of these colors take into the memory. So let's look at the on this table here on your left side and the picture on the right side. So when if a picture which has the two colors, which is black and white, so it takes the memory 1 bit in the computer memory. When we are talking about 4 bit size and it contains 16 colors, so you can see from here the picture has been improved with using these colors. But we are using like 8 bit, then to 56, 15 bits, it takes 32,768. Then up to 24, it's having like 16 million colors in the this size of the memory of the computer. So if you look at the summary of this color depth, so if we are talking about two colors, which takes only 1 bit in the computer, and the second thing is the bit size when increase is a 24 and it takes 16 million around colors. So now the objective of our lecture is to understand the seismic resolution. So similarly, if a picture have two type of resolution like color depth and the pixel, in seismic we have two type of resolution. So when we are talking about specifically, so it's a vertical or temporal resolution, and the second one is spatial or the horizontal resolution. So what is actually vertical or temporal resolution? It's actually the ability to detect the thin bands. So in the subsurface, let's say you have very thin bands, and when your temporal resolution is low, then you cannot see the thin band. So this is defined by the frequency. So if the frequency is higher, then better is your resolution. So it means you can look at the thin bands in the subsurface. So the second thing is spatial resolution. So it's the ability to determine the edge or bed termination, such as fault, fractures, pinch outs, any stratigraphic features, or even the structural feature also. So these are actually two type of resolution in seismic. So as I mentioned, the higher the frequency and the image will be have the higher resolution. So the highest frequency and the imaging aperture are the key determination factor for seismic resolution. For an unmigrated data, the fresnel zone is also used for the migrated data, which is the Rayleigh criteria, in which the Rayleigh criteria is used. So the equation for resolution is lambda is equal to V over F. So in case if we have the velocity 2500 meters per second and your frequency is 50 hertz, then your wavelength will be 50. So if we look at the resolution, so which is normally lambda by 4, which is equal to 12.5 meter. So it means that using this frequency 50 hertz in case of velocity which is 2500 meter per second, then you can image only 12.5 meter thick band. So the band which is below the 12.5 meter, it will not be resolved in the seismic. But note down that there is still ongoing research using that methods. You can go up to lambda by 4. So it's normally when we use the low frequency and high frequency models from the well logs, then you can improve your seismic frequencies. So the temporal resolution, which is actually to detect the thin band. So if you talk about the low frequency, so this is actually a low frequency wave. And if you talk about the wavelength, so it starts from this crest to this part. And the resolution is actually lambda by 4, so the fourth of this wavelength. So if in this case your resolution is this one, but when we are using the high frequency, then your wavelength decrease, I mean it's become smaller, and your lambda or your lambda by 4 will be more smaller. So it means you can see more thinner band for this high frequency wave rather than this low frequency. But it depends on your objective as well. So because seismic use low frequencies. So an example for temporal resolution. So let's say if you have three layer model. So this is layer one, layer two, and layer three. So when we are using the low frequency, which is low resolution, thin layer is not resolved. So in this case, if your frequency is low, then you can't see this thin layer because it cannot resolve these thin beds because it's below the resolution of the frequency. And when we are talking about the high frequency, so in high frequency, you have the high resolution. So in here, you can see you can resolve these two thin beds. So there is actually limits for the vertical resolution. So let's say if you have the three beds, like this is first, second, third. So if the wave passes through these three beds or the subsurface geology, then you have the seismic trace, the first one, then the second, and the third one. Because in between this, you have no any change in acoustic impedance. But let's say if this bed become very small, I mean, it's becoming smaller in this direction. When it becomes small, then you can see the seismic can resolve in this layer. So still you can resolve or you can identify this layer. So it is called half wavelength. Then if the bed is very small, and this is called the unresolved layer. So in when the wave passes through and the frequency is low, then it cannot resolve this layer. And even in this one and this one, it appears as a single layer. So that is, so it is unresolved layer, and in here we have the single reflection. So these two appears to be same, but if you use the high frequency, then you can resolve these two layers at the subsurface. So now we look at the lateral resolution. So in lateral resolution, normally it's the reflections come from the zone rather than the point, because if in the subsurface you have this layer, so the reflection actually comes from this zone rather than is a point. So this zone is actually called your Fresnel zone. So in this, the wave passes from here and here. So you have the reflection from this point as well. So this is called, and this also depends on the depth, velocity, and frequency, and how the frequency or the velocity of these two layers are changing. If you look at mathematically, which is T naught is equal to double of the depth divided by velocity, in is approximately equal to V by 2 under root T naught over F. So in this case, the F is your dominant frequency. Further looking at the spatial resolution or the horizontal resolution, so it is actually the lateral resolution which accounts for the lateral extent of the subsurface body. Let's say in subsurface you have one geobody you want to identify, but your spatial receiver spacing is not good enough to identify. So I'll give you an example. So let's say in subsurface you are looking for a small lens shape object like this one, but when you design your survey, let's say this part of the body is 10 meter, I mean from here to here is a 10 meter, but when you define your spacing interval is actually the 10 meter interval. So when you define your first receiver plot here, the second one is here and third one is here. So when the wave passes through, because there is no acoustic impedance, then you don't get anything. But from here you get two acoustic impedance contrast because this velocity and this velocity changes. So then you have the seismic wave recorded or the disruption recorded in this section, but obviously you don't know the lateral extent because it's not recorded here. So it's either extending up to here or up to, or maybe it's a small part of a body. So that's why you need a spatial resolution. So it's mean in that case you have multiple, or you have to reduce the space of your channels or your receivers. So in this case, let's say if we have let's assume it's a 1 meter spacing. So from here to here, from here to here, you have 10 traces. So from that, you can identify the full object of the subsurface body. So there is some ideal threshold for the vertical resolution. So let's say if you're in your subsurface, you have different velocity and the frequency which you are using is different, this one, then what will be the resolution of your subsurface? So let's say in case of 2000 meter per second velocity and you are using 50 hertz dominant frequency, then you can look at only 10 meter thick bed or thin beds. But if your velocity increase and frequency decrease, then obviously it's become like that. But most of the time in deeper region, let's say if you go up to 3-4 kilometers in the subsurface, so the velocity is also increased if it is a compacted rocks. So it goes up to 5,000 meters per second. And obviously the frequency, if the dominant frequency at the top is 50, when it goes deeper, then your frequency also losses. So in the deeper region, your resolution is low. I mean, it depends, because in the deeper region, obviously your structures are very big and your layers are very thick. So it goes up to 60 to 70 meter thick bed. So because of that, obviously in seismic, we are not looking very thin beds in this deep region or the 4 to 5 kilometer, because it will not be economical. So I have just one example for you to understand the seismic resolution. So as you know, this is actually the KLCC from the Twin Tower from Petronas, Malaysia. So if you look at, we plot one of the wave on top of this Twin Tower, just to understand how important is one wave which is passing, or we are looking at the seismic section. So in this case, if the velocity is 2400 meter per second and the frequency is 40 hertz, then your lambda is 60 meter. So from here you can see, if a wave is passing through this part, and from bottom to here you have 170 meter, because the total height of this tower is 452 meter. So when you plot a seismic on top of this, so you can see this is actually the wavelength. And the resolution for this bed is up to here. I mean, so if you are looking at subsurface, a wave or a seismic section, so you don't consider that this is giving a very minor information, because in the backhand, it's giving a very big information of the subsurface. So let's say if you miss this part, and this is your reservoir, then probably you are missing a very big reservoir in the subsurface. So the resolution is very important. I mean, an understanding of the resolution is also very important for you to understand the seismic and go for hydrocarbon exploration. So with that's all. Thank you so much. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture and hope to see you again. Thank you.